Dear students, I hope you are doing fine. In this video tutorial, I'll be providing some examples of countable and uncountable sets. So to establish the countability of the sets, I'll either be providing some formal proofs, or in case the formal proofs are complicated, I'll be providing the geometric arguments. For definitions and some more examples on countable sets, you may refer to my previous video tutorial. I'm providing the link in the description box.
So let's start with the examples of countable and uncountable sets. The first example which I am going to consider is the set n cross n, where it contains all such pairs m, n such that m and n are natural numbers. So I am going to enumerate the elements of the set in this manner. In the first row, I will be placing elements where the first component is fixed to 1 and the second component varies as 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. In the second row, I am taking those elements where the first component is 2 and the second component, it varies from 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. Similarly, I have the third row, fourth row, and in this manner, I am going to enumerate all the elements of the set n cross n. Now, this enumeration we can see is following a sort of a diagonal procedure. So, what is the diagonal procedure? The first diagonal I would take up as containing the single element 1, 1. The second diagonal I'll consider having elements 1, 2 and 2, 1. Along the next diagonal, I'll take up elements 1, 3, 2, 2, 3, 1. Then I'll move up to the next diagonal. And in this manner, we can see that each diagonal has a finitely many number of elements. What else do we observe here? We also observe that the sum of components which are lying on every diagonal is same. For example, on the first diagonal, this single element has sum of components as 2. Along the second diagonal, I have these two elements and in both of them, sum of components is 3. Along the next diagonal, the sum of components comes out to be 4 for every pair m, n. So in this manner, we can see that every diagonal has a fixed sum. Now, if we write this in a tabular form, what do we observe? Along the first diagonal, the sum of the components is 2. This is the element which is there. Number of elements is 1. And cumulative number of elements is 1. On the second diagonal, I have the sum of components as 3. There are these two elements, 1, 2 and 2, 1. And the number of elements till this particular diagonal is 1 plus 2. Along the next diagonal, I again observe a similar pattern. Sum is 4, there are 3 elements and cumulative number of elements till this diagonal is 1 plus 2 plus 3. Similarly, for the fourth diagonal, the number of elements till here is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. So, if I generalize it for the k minus 1th and kth diagonals, we have the following observation. Along the k minus 1th diagonal, the sum of components is always k. These are the k minus 1 elements which are there and the number of elements in the diagonals from 1 through k minus 1, that is till this stage, are 1 plus 2 plus so on till k minus 1, which can also be written as k minus 1 into k divided by 2. Moving on to the kth diagonal, again we see that sum of the components is k plus 1. These are the k elements along this diagonal and the number of elements in the diagonals from 1 through k is 1 plus 2 plus so on till k, which is nothing but k into k plus 1 by 2. So, if we take any general element of the set m cross n, which is mn, such that it lies in the kth diagonal, then we have m plus n is equal to k plus 1 or k is m plus n minus 1. So, if we follow this earlier mentioned counting scheme, we will see that the number of elements in diagonals from 1 through k minus 1 is k minus 1 into k divided by 2, which we have earlier also mentioned here, and that is equal to m plus n minus 2 into m plus n minus 1 divided by 2. And after this, when we move on to the kth diagonal, the element m, n is counted in the mth place. So that is how we establish the counting scheme. So let's see it once again. How do we establish the counting scheme? Along the first diagonal, the element 1, 1 is counted as the first number, or we can say it is being mapped to the first natural number. Along the second diagonal, we have these two elements 1, 2 and 2, 1. And we'll be mapping them to the next two natural numbers, that is 2 and 3. So that is, we are counting this element as the second and this one as the third. Moving on to the third diagonal, again, I'm going to take all these elements where the sum of components is 4 and they are mapped to the next set of natural numbers, which are 4, 5 and 6. So in this manner, if I cover up all the k minus 1 diagonals, moving on to the kth diagonal, my first element, which is 1 comma k, is mapped to the element k minus 1 into k divided by 2 plus 1. Why plus 1? Because now it is the first element in the kth diagonal. Then similarly, mnth element will be assigned the position k minus 1 into k divided by 2 plus m, or it is mapped to this particular natural number, and this is nothing but m plus n minus 2 into m plus n minus 1 divided by 2 plus m. So what do we notice here? We see that we can form a function f from n cross n to n, such that f of mn is this particular expression which we have just seen, that is m plus n minus 2 into m plus n minus 1 divided by 2 plus m. And this function is a bijection. So for the formal proof of this being a bijection, you can refer to this particular reference which I mentioned in the end, or if you want, you may also email me at this particular email ID. So hence we can conclude that n cross n is a denumerable set. The second method for the same particular set which I have just considered is like this. I am again going to enumerate the elements of the set in the same manner, and then I am going to put the elements of the first row in a new set which I'll call A1. So what will A1 contain? All such pairs where the first component is 1. Then the second row elements, I am going to put them in the set A2, where it will contain all such pairs with the first component as 2. Similarly, third row is saved in the set A3, fourth row goes to the set A4. So in this manner, I am going to write all such rows in terms of certain sets. So what do we see? That each AM here, the A1, A2, A3 and A4 sets here are countable sets for each natural number, and we can write the set n cross n as union of all these AMs. Now there is a theorem which says that if AM is a countable set for each natural number, then the union AM, which is the set A, is also a countable set. So hence, since n cross n is also written as this particular union, therefore it is a countable set. And since the set is infinite, hence it has to be denumerable. Moving on to this next example, I am now going to take the set of rational numbers, which is denoted by the letter Q. Now, I am going to use a theorem here which says that the following statements are equivalent. First statement is that S is a countable set. Second statement says there exists a surjection of N onto S. And third says there exists an injection of S into N. Now, saying that these are equivalent means A, whenever it holds, would imply B. B, if it holds, would imply C. And C, if it holds, would imply back A. So how are we going to use this? For that, first, as we have already seen that n cross n is a countable set, then using this above theorem, we can say that there exists a surjection f of n onto n cross n. So we have a mapping f of n onto n cross n such that f is a surjective mapping. Next, we are going to consider a mapping g from n cross n to q plus. What is q plus? Q plus is the set of positive rational numbers, and we define it as GMN is M divided by N. Now clearly you can see that given any such rational number in the set Q plus, we can always find a pair M comma N such that GMN is M by N. So that makes G a surjective mapping. So hence the composition G of F, which is defined from N to Q plus, is a surjection. So again, using the previous theorem, we can say that Q plus is a countable set, Now, in a similar manner, we can also show that Q minus is a countable set. Now, the set Q, which we can write as Q minus union the singleton 0 union Q plus, is also a countable set. Why? Because it is the union of three disjoint countable sets. So, as now Q also contains N, so it has to be a denumerable set as well. Now, the third example which I am going to consider is the set of real numbers. So, here I am going to use a theorem which says that let A and B be two sets such that A is a subset of B. Then, if B is a countable set, A would always be a countable set. And if A is an uncountable set, it would imply that B is an uncountable set. Now, for proving that set of real numbers is uncountable, I'll first take an interval I, which is containing all real numbers between 0 and 1. Then I is clearly a subset of the set of real numbers. So, firstly, we aim to show that I is an uncountable set. So, if we are able to prove that I is uncountable, what would happen is, from the above theorem, we will be able to say that R is an uncountable set. Now, we assume to the contrary, that is, we assume that I is a countable set. Let us take any element X in the set I. Then, since I contains all real numbers between 0 and 1, this X will have a decimal representation of the form 0.d1, d2, d3 and so on, where each digit di is a digit from 0 to 9. Now, let us further assume that the enumeration of all the numbers in I is given by x1, x2, x3 and so on. So, since this is the set of all the numbers in the set I, so x1 is given by 0.d11, d12, d13 and so on. x2 we denoted by 0.d21, d22 and so on. Similarly, x3 is given this particular decimal representation and so for xn. Now, what do we do further is, we define another real number, call it y, and we give it a decimal representation of the form 0.y1, y2, y3 and so on, where we define each yi in this manner. Yi is 1 if dii is greater than or equal to 5 and yi is 6 if dii is less than 5. So, when we define this y in this manner, we will observe the following. First point we note here is that since none of the yi's is either 0 or 9, it is not equal to any of the numbers with two decimal representations. So, what does that mean? That this particular y will not be equal to a number which may have two different decimal representations. So, for more information on this, you may refer to these particular references, which again I've mentioned at the end, and you can see why this happens. The second observation which we have here is that y differs from each of these xi's which have been listed in at least one decimal place, which is the ith place. So, how does it differ? Now, since y1 is 1 if my d11 is greater than or equal to 5 and it is 6 if my d11 is less than 5, it would never be equal to this number d11. So, y would differ from x1 at this particular place. Then, similarly, since y2 is 1 again, if d22 is greater than or equal to 5 and it will be 6 if d22 is less than 5, so it will never be the same as x2 because it differs from x2 in this particular decimal position. Similarly, it will differ from x3 in this decimal place and it will differ with xn in this particular decimal place. So, we can say that this y is not equal to xn for any n belonging to the set of natural numbers. Hence, y is not included in the enumeration of I, which we had said was complete. So, it contradicts the fact that this x1, x2, x3 is the complete enumeration of numbers in I. So, that contradicts the fact that I was a countable set, which implies I is uncountable and hence the set of real numbers is also uncountable. The next example which I am going to consider is the set of irrational numbers. It is denoted by R minus Q. And I'm going to use a theorem here which says that union of two disjoint countable sets is a countable set. Now, firstly, we are going to write R as union of Q and R minus Q. Now, we note the following. Firstly, Q is a countable set. We have just now seen. R is an uncountable set. That also we have proved. So, if we assume that the set of irrationals is a countable set, from this above theorem, we would have two disjoint countable sets here, and hence their union would also be countable. And what is the union of these two sets? The set of real numbers. So we would get that the set of real numbers is also countable, but that's not true. We have already seen that set of real numbers is an uncountable set. So this gives us a contradiction, and hence it proves that the set of irrationals is an uncountable set. So these are the references which I had mentioned. The first reference can be referred to for the formal proof of why the function was a bijection which existed between n cross n and n, and the second and the third references can be used to study more on the decimal representations of real numbers. So that's all in this video tutorial. The next video tutorial will be uploaded soon, and till then keep studying and stay safe.